the unexpected side effects of prohibition during the 13 years that changed America.
In 1920s America, liquor was banned. The law of prohibition came from a century of campaigning by moral crusaders. It created an epidemic of immorality and law-breaking, as thousands of ordinary people became criminals in order to keep their fellows drinking. And then the big shots moved in. Al Capone, who ran the city of Chicago on illegal liquor money. And his worst enemy, the Untouchables. They brought machine guns to American cities and corrupted the highest powers in the land. America was about to discover the real cost of prohibition.
You get mad when I call you old. You got the key in your hand, but can't find the hole. Yes, you drink too much. You can't do nothing, cause you drink too much.
What I do, da da do.
The city of Chicago, the 20s roared louder than any other in America. The nation was prosperous and looking up, and many said prohibition had brought it there. But the ideal of a sober nation was just a mask. The real face of America could be found in the gutter, an underworld supplying a wet America.
It makes no difference if it's sweet or hot.
Behind its dry facade, the nation was drinking. Hypocrisy was at the very heart of prohibition. Its double standards had created an America with two faces. But in 1929, one event in Chicago revealed the true face of Prohibition America. One of America's bloodiest peacetime killings came out of Prohibition. The St. Valentine's Day Massacre terrified the country and set America on the road to repeal.
The whole thing was in the newspapers, and it was such a shocking event that I think, was definite that prohibition had to go. They murdered the seven of them right like that. And I think that was really a turning point to people in the cities, you know, that said, this is the end.
To the nation, prohibition had failed. It had created these gangsters. The movement to repeal the law gathered such support that within 2 years they dared to challenge the 18th Amendment to the United States Constitution.
The 18th Amendment has delivered this nation bound hand and foot to organized crime, financed by racketeers and gangsters, which are all synonymous with bootleggers.
There was one bootlegger who personified all that was wrong with the Prohibition law, Al Capone, the man behind the St. Valentine's Day Massacre. He crystallized the hypocrisy of the time. Even before the massacre, he represented the frightening grip that crime had throughout America. To Capone, it was just business.
Al Capone said many times, "Don't blame me. I'm only supplying what the demand is." And the demand was great, not only in Chicago, in every place in the United States.
To America, Capone's open reign of crime embodied the hopelessness of enforcing prohibition. But in Chicago, Capone was thought of very differently. To many, he had been a Robin Hood, a gentleman, a philanthropist. He had brought money and excitement to the city. At his peak, Capone was turning over $105 million a year. His business employed thousands. He murdered his rivals and controlled every racket in town. His liquor convoys ran to every major city. He had policemen and politicians in his pocket. In Chicago, there was only one law, and it was Capone's. Gang boss and people's hero. Like Prohibition, his image was a contradiction. Chicago was his city. He brought the people's music, the sound of the age. He brought jazz. Doc Cheatham came to play for Capone.
He loved musicians and he loved jazz. So that was his baby, as they say. So the city just lit up overnight, lights and everything. The city, everybody was making money. And it was because of Al Capone. He was selling his beer and whiskey to every place, as long as any place in Chicago. He ruled that. No, he could sell whiskey to the post office. He didn't care. Beer and everything. Because he ruled town, and he had to do what he wanted to do.
He brought jazz greats from New Orleans, like Louis Armstrong, King Oliver, and Duke Ellington. Lucille Zinman would go to hear the jazz at Capone's speakeasies.
Any nightclub you went to, you saw Al with about two other men and three women at the table. And very often the women were women that you knew from the show who had made a date with Al Capone. He was a very fair-skinned Italian with impeccable dress, and he was very much of a gentleman in that capacity.
Everything was okay then. Plenty of work, plenty of money, plenty of girls, plenty of this, plenty of that. And everybody was happy.
Under Prohibition, Capone united Chicago. Like him, the city had two distinct faces. It was built on the frontier between civilization and the wilderness. It brought together urban corruption and Wild West lawlessness. It was a city steeped in blood, built around the slaughterhouses. Its business was butchery. Many believe Prohibition created the mob, but in this city, gangsters ruled long before. Walter Trohan was a journalist in Chicago.
Chicago had crime before Prohibition. I remember as a young boy, a few blocks from my grandmother, a fella died named Enright, Moss Enright, with a revolver in one hand and a rosary in the other. That was before Prohibition. But when Prohibition came, the gangsters found a new source of revenue.
These gangsters had divided Chicago. The city's immigrant populations huddled together in clearly defined ethnic areas: Italian, Irish, Polish, Jewish. The gangs defended their own racial territory. It was Prohibition which allowed Capone to break the mold. When he started his own operation, it was not in Little Italy, but where the alcohol ban was most keenly felt. He chose Cicero, an industrial suburb where 30,000 beer-drinking Germans lived. With his brothers Ralph and Frank, he ruled by intimidation and fear from his headquarters at the Hawthorne Inn. On local polling day, Capone put gunmen on the roofs of Cicero, forcing voters to elect the weak and wet officials already on his payroll. By 1924, Cicero had 100 saloons and 150 casinos, all controlled by Capone and his henchmen. His rule over Cicero was absolute. But one man dared to speak out against him, a young newspaper editor called Robert St. John.
My newspaper was dedicated to driving Scarface Al Capone out of Cicero. As I was going to my office early one morning, a big black touring car came roaring up. The car screeched to a stop. Four men jumped out. At first, I didn't know whether they were plainclothes detectives or gangsters, but I then recognized Ralph Capone as one of them, so I knew. I fell to the ground and curled myself up in a ball because I knew what was about to happen.
St. John suffered a bloody beating.
I was some days in the hospital. When I went to pay my bill, the hospital cashier said, "Oh, your bill was paid this morning." And I said, "Oh, that can't be. Who paid it?" She said, "A man came in," and I said, "Describe the man." Well, she said the only thing that was unusual about him is he had a scar on his left cheek. Of course, it was Scarface Al Capone. He had paid my bill.
Violence and charity, Capone's double game. What he could not intimidate, he would buy. When St. John persisted, Capone bought the Cicero Tribune. He left its editor only one option.
I gathered up a few things from my desk, and I put on my hat and coat, and I left my office, never to return. I've never been back to Cicero since.
By 1924, the suburb of Cicero had been bought. Capone now headed into Chicago. Prohibition had been devised to impose cultural unity on the immigrant population. But it was Capone and the illegal liquor trade which really brought them together.
Al Capone especially worked very hard to break out of narrow ethnic boundaries and to build a political coalition that reached across ethnic boundaries. So he formed liaisons with Jewish gangsters, with Irish gangsters, with Polish gangsters, and with black gangsters. This was very unusual. In fact, this was unprecedented in American history. By building this coalition, which was in effect a political coalition, he was able to amplify his power a great deal.
Capone drew his gang without prejudice from all the immigrant communities. Prohibition had made alcohol the number one criminal earner. There were low fines for being caught and high rewards for getting it through. The competition between racketeers and bootleggers to control the liquor trade was heated. Openly defying the law, their armed liquor trucks drove across the country and through each other's territories. The Sicilian Jenna brothers even paid the police to escort their liquor trucks. When the Irish O'Banion gang hijacked the Jenna brothers' convoy, they sparked off a bloodbath. Shootings, murders, and retaliations. They called it the Beer Wars. Capone's multi-ethnic gang was able to divide and rule, side with the winners, and set each gang against each other. There were 136 gangland killings in the first 5 years of Prohibition. There was only one conviction.
You must remember that at that time, the state government, the county government, the city government, all governments, local governments, were under the control of Al Capone and his mob. They could not get convictions. You couldn't get juries that were brave enough to stand up to those people. Witnesses were subpoenaed, were appear, and they were murdered. Big problem in those days was staying alive, keeping the prosecutor alive as well as the witnesses.
Prohibition had corrupted the law. It was authority's way to control its citizens. But in Chicago, it was Capone who controlled authority. Walter Trohan was on a story when he visited one of Chicago's police station houses.
I went up to the the stairway, and I was frisked by two men who halted me, took me, and felt to see if I had any revolvers, and I was indignant. I was a reporter. I was an important person, in my own opinion. And I went to the police captain and protested at the Harrison. I said, "You're goons," I guess, words to that effect, frisked me as I was going up to the station. And the captain looked at me and said, "Those weren't my men. Those were Capone's bodyguards," which was an astounding thing to me, and I reported it. The fact that Capone not only went into the station, but his bodyguards frisked everybody who went up to be sure they weren't carrying a gun to shoot Capone.
Capone faced many assassination attempts. He always got away. By 1926, Capone had manipulated the prohibition law, the gangs, and the police. All that was left was public opinion. He rarely let photographers take the scarred side of his face. The Prohibition Act had proved that a good image was a great cover for bad behavior. Prohibition made Capone an emperor. He ruled from his new palace, the Metropole Hotel in central Chicago. A little Caesar, his reign over the city had crossed national divides. It conquered and united disparate European communities. Prohibition had elevated Capone to wealth and respect. The outlawing of alcohol had taken him to the top. Just as Ford made Detroit, Capone made Chicago. He ate the industrialist. He employed the city.
When I came to Chicago, I had only $40 in my pocket. I went into business that was open and didn't do anybody any harm. Hundreds of young men, thanks to me, are getting from $150 to $200 a week.
We would go about in public and people would cheer, their benevolent city father. They would happily wave at the murderer. Capone courted their support. Tony Berardi covered the races for the Chicago Evening News.
Now, I used to like to bet a few dollars on a horse. And Al Capone and his bodyguards are walking by. And he says, "Hey, kid, how you doing?" I said, "I'm doing okay, because I made a few dollars." He says, "Why don't you bet on number six?" Now, I'm a racing form horse bettor. I looked at the racing form, and the horse that he mentioned, he only mentioned it by number. I looked at him, and he was a steeplehorse horse. I said, "Oh, my God, how the hell can he win this race?" Well, in a horse race language, he opened up at 99-1, and then he was going down, and he went down to about 60-1, and one of his bodyguards stuck a ticket in my pocket and walked away. I look at the ticket, and it's $5 win ticket on this number six. Sure enough, number six won by a half a block. Paid, well, I got $322 for my for that $5.
He may have controlled the racetrack, but Capone wanted much more. Even as he was killing rivals on the streets, he was buying his most expensive status symbol, a new mayor, his mayor, Bill Thompson.
Al Capone spent $250,000 on Big Bill Thompson's second mayoral campaign. It was probably the best money that Capone ever spent because it bought him a great deal of political support and protection. Once Big Bill Thompson became mayor for his second term, he disappeared. He went hunting in Michigan and wasn't seen or heard from for months on end. So, in effect, there was really nobody to run Chicago during this era except for the gangsters.
Thompson did little to mask his own anti-prohibition sympathies. He was even elected on a promise to be wetter than the Atlantic Ocean.
When Thompson died, they opened a safety deposit box and I found $2 million in cash and bills in the safety deposit. This money was obviously illegitimate. It came from corrupt sources, or sources buying favors or receiving favors, such as the bringing alcohol into the loop by the Capone mob.
With the mayor under Capone's thumb, Chicago was completely clutched in the fist of the mob. But one man from Chicago he could not buy was America's vice president, Charles Dawes. He pleaded with the nation to face up to the consequences of prohibition.
They have created a super government in Chicago, which is levying tribute upon citizens and enforcing collection by terrorizing, kidnapping, and assassinations. These alien outlaws have become fabulously rich as rum runners and bootleggers, working in collusion with the police and other officials, openly defying the Constitution of the United States.
Capone's empire had proved to America that the 18th Amendment was impossible to enforce. From its very beginning, there had been opposition to prohibition. But the voice of the drive movement was so strong, it hushed any murmurs against it. After 7 years, one of the whispers began to shout, the National Association Against the Prohibition Amendment. In 1927, they called a meeting in Washington. Some of America's most powerful men gathered, determined to break the law of prohibition. No law in the Constitution has ever been removed. The only solution was to fight for a new amendment, one to repeal prohibition.
It was utterly unthinkable that prohibition would ever be repealed. Two-thirds of the Congress had voted for prohibition. Now, two-thirds of the Congress would have to vote the other way. 44 states had voted for prohibition. Now they would almost all have to reverse that decision. For politicians to announce that they had been wrong and to reverse their position was a very difficult thing for them to do.
But the men who steered the association could not be intimidated by federal power. They were wealthy, influential company bosses like Henry Bourne Joy of the Packard Motor Company, Charles H. Sabin of the Guaranteed Trust Company, and the chairman, Pierre DuPont, president of General Motors. Before Prohibition, he had supported the move for a dry America and had donated large sums to the Anti-Saloon League. A sober workforce, he assumed, would be an efficient workforce. But for 7 years, DuPont had watched Capone doing business and suffering no penalties. DuPont paid the enforcement taxes heaped on America's industrialists. Now he changed face. Repeal was right. The association launched an aggressive propaganda campaign. Prohibition was unconstitutional. It had stimulated crime, lost liquor tax, and cost a fortune to enforce. But most American voters felt that they had prospered during Prohibition. In 1928, they voted in a Republican government for a third term, and a new president, Herbert Hoover, who backed Prohibition.
Our country has undertaken a great social and economic experiment, noble in motive and far-reaching in purpose. It must be worked out constructively.
But in calling it an experiment, even Hoover recognized that prohibition might be temporary. Hoover set up a commission to investigate its progress.
I propose to appoint a national commission for a searching investigation of the whole structure of our federal system of jurisprudence, to include the method of enforcement of the 18th Amendment and the causes of abuse under it. Its purpose will be to make such recommendations for the reorganization of the administration of federal laws and court procedure as may be found desirable.
To target Capone, Hoover appointed a new attorney general for Chicago. His name was George Johnson. He vowed to put Capone behind bars. His son remembers the size of the task.
My father conceived the idea to go after Al Capone, Ralph Capone, Jack Gusick, and all these guys on violations of income tax. And I'm reasonably sure that President Hoover encouraged my father to continue this very dangerous hunt.
Amassing enough evidence of Capone's financial dealings to get a tax evasion indictment was never going to be easy for Johnson. Gambling, vice, and bootlegging were all cash businesses, and Capone made sure his name was always three or four times removed from any actual operation.
I think my father had an absolute moral outrage against Al Capone. He was evil, but then he had this pretense of respectability, arrogance. He would try to do these good things for society. He tried to pose as Robin Hood. Well, of course, all this is very false. And this, I think, particularly annoyed my father and drove him on. My father conceived the idea of hiring some fresh talent. And he hired Elliot Ness practically out of college, University of Chicago, and five other agents at the time. He gave them the name, "You're the Untouchables. Let's go get them, guys."
Ness raided Capone's liquor stills, but it would take the Untouchables over 3 years to find enough evidence to pin Capone down. In 1928, the beer wars had resulted in 367 murders and 115 bombs in the city. But in the following year, the violence would culminate in a massacre which even shocked Chicago. It rocked America.
About 10 o'clock that morning, which was Valentine's Day, 1929, I believe, I got a call and told me to go to 2122 something North Clark Street. Well, as I got there was a police officer in front, and he was not going to let me in, and I just shoved my way in. I got on top of I'll call it a truck or whatever it was, and shot down pictures of down, and then I got off of this truck and made about a half a dozen different photographs of these bodies.
They had been shot, just half a dozen of them lying there, some of them with their heads, top of their head blown off. A river of blood, really, a terrific amount, let's put it that way. And a wild shepherd dog, German shepherd, going crazy at the end of a chain, lunging at anybody and everybody. Very curious thing, it became a sideshow in Chicago. Every reporter in town, virtually, came there to look at it. Most of the politicians came to take a look at it. The place, the parade of people, and there was this lineup of corpses in a tangle and in a mess. It was not a pleasant sight.
Seven bullet-riddled bodies, Bugs Moran's henchmen. They had tried to hijack one of Capone's liquor trucks. Jack Machine Gun McGurn, Capone's right-hand man, had shown Chicago exactly who was the boss.
Willis O'Rourke of the Chicago Evening American went in and looked it over and came out, looked down at his feet, and said, "I got more brains on my feet than I have in my head," which I remember because it was an apt remark, gruesome but apt. Also, the Evening American that evening carried a great line: "Chicago gangsters graduated from killings to massacres," which was true.
With the St. Valentine's Day massacre, the whole of America woke up to the true face of Prohibition. The newspapers with their stark pictures crystallized Chicago's entire bloody history into an instant of horror. Millions of Americans realized that Prohibition had created Al Capone, that he was the man behind the massacre. The feelings against him and Prohibition intensified. People looked to the repealists for an answer, but the National Association Against the Prohibition Amendment seemed only concerned with cold statistics and dull taxes. It was the wives of this millionaire club who captured the hearts of America and the feeling of the time. In the wake of the St. Valentine's Day massacre, Pauline Sabin, a politically active aristocratic New Yorker, launched the Women's Organization for National Prohibition Reform. A decade before, the women of America had been Prohibition's most impassioned supporters. Seeing themselves as guardians of the home and morality, they fought to close the saloons. Prohibition had promised to protect their family and children from the evils of drink. But by the end of the 20s, Sabin said that Prohibition had failed. American children were growing up in a lawless world where drinking was fashionable. With no age limits, young people could go to speakeasies serving unregulated liquor. They didn't know what they were drinking.
Oh, they threw anything in there. Iodine, coloring, alcohol, grain alcohol. In fact, as a result of the rot gut type of liquors that were being used, people were blinded, actually blinded by what they were drinking. Every night, ambulances will pick people up in neighborhood taverns and rush them to a hospital to have their stomach pumped because of the foulness of this type of liquor.
The dangers of liquor were all too clear to Sabin. On May 28, 1929, in Chicago, Capone's own city, Sabin brought together women from all over America, formally launching the Women's Organization to Fight Prohibition.
It has led to more violation of and contempt for law, to more hypocrisy among both private citizens as well as public officials than any other thing in our national life. It is responsible for the greatest organized criminal class in this country, and I believe that the time has come for us to organize and to work for some sane solution of this problem, which will replace the present corruption, lawlessness, and hypocrisy with honesty and sobriety.
I think the women's organization made Prohibition repeal eminently respectable. When women, especially women like Pauline Sabin, prominent in society, certainly identified as conservative women, were advocating Prohibition repeal, it made it far more respectable than it had been when it was simply something advocated by brewers, distillers, recent immigrants to the United States, and a few people who seemed out of the political mainstream.
In the name of true temperance and sobriety, the women's organization quickly gathered support. Within weeks, there were over 100,000 members. With posters and petitions, they launched a national campaign. But repeal still seemed remote. Women could vote, but there were only men in Congress, and few wanted change in these prosperous, confident times. But on the 17th of October, 1929, confidence snapped. Wall Street crashed. The New York stock market collapsed. America faced up to reality.
We had very prominent men going out windows in tall buildings. There was wholesale suicides. It was heart-rending. And I remember once my mother said that she had come in from shopping somewhere, and she said, on the four corners were four men that you could tell must have had better lives their appearance, and the four men were selling apples on the corner, and that disturbed her.
With the Wall Street crash of 1929, all the arguments that the prohibitionists had used, that prohibition was going to turn America into a prosperous country, were no longer valid. Taxes had risen with the Depression because the economy was failing, and simply to get the government to continue to work, they needed to raise taxes at all levels. And if prohibition was rescinded, liquor could be taxed again, and this would be a very valuable source of revenue and reduce taxes.
Prohibition had been credited for the nation's prosperity. Now it was blamed for the country's poverty. The Depression gave Pierre Dupont the economic weapon that he needed.
When we kill prohibition, we give jobs to the unemployed, start the upswing to better businesses, and provide $1 billion a year to wipe out the government's deficit.
Those who still supported prohibition, like the Women's Christian Temperance Union, accused repealists like DuPont of just wanting to reduce their own taxes. Ella Milton was a member of the union and had fought hard for national prohibition.
People who were wealthy, for instance the DuPonts, had done everything dry until they decided that if prohibition were repealed, they wouldn't have to pay so much income tax. So they changed from being dry people to having people work. They gave their money to help repeal it. They even got women to be parts of it. Women who were wives or connected with public officials, high officials in the government. And these people all worked, and they paid people to break the law.
The accusations of the dry union fell on deaf ears. By now, its leaders were seen as old-fashioned, pinch-nosed religious fanatics from a world that lay far behind them. Sabin's repeal movement represented the cosmopolitan, politically aware woman of the 30s. They were self-consciously modern, more deft with publicity, and more dynamic than their opponents. Sabin was as respectable as the Drys. While the Women's Christian Temperance Union struggled to keep its members, Sabin's organization attracted publicity and support. The repeal movement organized parades across America demanding beer and liquor. Women had brought prohibition in before they even got the vote. Now, if women backed repeal, their united vote might break it. The end of prohibition suddenly seemed very possible. Throughout the 20s, the old brewers had been reduced to silence, manufacturing soft drinks and ice cream. Finally, these fallen giants spoke out.
They promised us a crimeless world. They have given us anarchy. Those who are obeying the law are being ground to pieces by its very operation, while those who are violating the law are reaping unheard of rewards. Every rule of justice has been reversed.
For Capone's empire, the rewards were all too evident. Time magazine estimated that Capone, public enemy number one, was personally worth $40 million. He was another tycoon contributing nothing to society. He wasn't even paying taxes. But after 3 years of investigation, Capone was still free. George Johnson's untouchables hadn't made a single conviction. The president was convinced that prohibition could be saved if Capone was put behind bars. He was growing impatient. Elliot Ness promoted himself as the hero of the Untouchables, who struck fear into the hearts of gangsters. But with a growing drink problem, he was not as untouchable as he claimed.
Elliot Ness, he became a womanizer, he became an alcoholic. Right, that's personal. But my father's objection, and I think all public enforcement, was that he, Ness, was so enamored with his own press that he would tell the press ahead of time where he's going to make a raid. And if they had television those days, you can imagine what a TV series that would have made.
Ness had learned about the power of publicity and image from his arch enemy. A year into the Depression, Capone was still playing nice guy, setting up soup kitchens for the poor.
Al Capone's soup kitchen to feed the hungry during the Depression took place on the eve of his conviction for income tax evasion. It was clear that he was trying to influence public opinion in his favor by doing this apparently generous act, because the people he were feeding were just the kind of people who were about to convict him and send him to jail. It didn't work, but it was a brilliant publicity ploy.
Contrary to myth, it was George Johnson rather than Ness who sealed Capone's fate. The realities of the Depression had helped to stroke the nation's conscience, and that was always going to be bad news for Capone. He was no Robin Hood. The jury found him guilty of tax evasion and sent him to jail for 11 years. On October the 24th, 1931, Capone was finally taken to prison. By getting rid of the figurehead, Hoover had not eliminated the reality. Capone was gone, but as the repealists pointed out, the racketeers, bootleggers, and gangsters remained. It was a coup for the Republican government, but it entrenched them still further in the Prohibition cause. With the elections only a year away, Franklin D. Roosevelt, the Democratic candidate, grabbed the chance to make repeal the moral platform for the Democratic vote. Pierre DuPont, a lifelong Republican, turned face and joined the Democrats.
While it is a disagreeable thing to desert one's political party, I could not stand for their ignoring the Prohibition question. It is an insult to our people.
It's no longer a question of liquor or no liquor. It's a question of racketeers or no racketeers. It's no longer a question of temperance. It's a question of the success or failure of the 18th Amendment as an aid to the end of temperance. We believe that the 18th Amendment has failed, and failed badly. I'm a reformed prohibitionist myself. I hoped it was going to work. I'm forced to admit that it has not.
Although the preacher and ex-baseball star Billy Sunday was a popular speaker for a dry America before Prohibition, by 1932 his arguments seemed to have lost their sense.
They say, well, people don't obey it, we'll repeal it. All right, then repeal the Ten Commandments. They don't obey them. And yet no law on the statute books is enforced 100%, and you know it. The distillery on the hillside now is still, and the men, they take their tickle from the ripple of the rill. The boys, they go home sober, and Ma, she don't cry. Glory, hallelujah, Uncle Sam will stay dry.
Prohibition was supposed to have brought liberty and freedom, but the association showed it was restrictive and totalitarian. They attacked the very Midwestern dries who introduced it.
It is not only wine and beer they would take from us. They plan also to forbid cigarettes, Sunday movies, a game of cards, in short, all the little diversions that add to the joy of life. They want to compel us by law to be just as gloomy as they are themselves. They are dictators and tyrants from afar. And I say it is time to shake off this sanctimonious long-distance domination, or life is not going to be worth living at all.
Under the Republicans, Americans had lived under the confines of Prohibition. They had seen the rise of gangs and suffered the greatest period of poverty in their history. Alcohol was at least a comfort for the Depression hit. Repeal was a winning issue for the Democrats. In 1932, Roosevelt was elected president on a landslide.
You good people are in a terrible hurry. I favor the modification of the Boston Act just as fast as the Lord let us. To permit such states as want to to authorize the manufacture and sale of beer. Remember that that is a way to divert $300 million or more by way of taxes from the pockets of the racketeers into the treasury of the United States.
Roosevelt immediately modified the Prohibition Act to allow 3.2% beer, and within a month he put repeal to the vote.
Overall, 21 million voters went to the polls, and 73% of them, on a national basis, voted for Prohibition repeal. The conventions went very smoothly. None lasted more than a day. The one in New Hampshire lasted something like 18 minutes. The delegates came in, said, "We vote for repeal of Prohibition," and that was that.
With repeal, the bootleggers disappeared. Most became legitimate liquor dealers. Joe Kennedy secured the exclusive distribution rights for Gordon's Gin.
Everybody wanted it. Everybody finally got it. And they were very persistent. I don't remember anything else in our country that only lasted 13 years and had such a wonderful reception because it was done. You know, it was really a big day.
Of course, I was ready to vote when Prohibition was repealed, and I listened to people talk. And by and large, the church people knew that was wrong. But there were people who were on the edge, and they listened to the wrong side, and they believed them, and they decided, well, maybe what they're saying is true. And I knew it was wrong, and I hurt terribly.
On December 5th, 1933, the 21st Amendment to the Constitution was ratified. It repealed all the laws set down in the 18th. But a repeal was not the end of Prohibition. 8 states even elected to keep it. It would take another 36 years before the whole of America was wet again. Kansas, where state prohibition was born, remained dry until 1948. Repeal never got rid of the gangsters. Prohibition had given the mob the momentum to infiltrate every American vice, gaining wealth far beyond Al Capone's. 8 years after leaving prison, he died, his mind rotted by syphilis. For America, 13 years of prohibition left a stigma on alcohol. Even now, more than a third of the country claim never to drink liquor. With the failure of prohibition, trust in federal government has been broken.
I think prohibition has had one great benefit. It has taught other people that prohibition is a mistake. Had it been different in this country, people might have experimented with it elsewhere. But now nobody wants, they know that it leads to trouble.
Prohibition had proved that no law is enforceable without the support of the people. Their basic rights are defined by the American Constitution, and prohibition remains its only amendment ever to be repealed. But if one can be repealed, what about the others? After prohibition, how secure is any amendment in the Constitution?
The concluding part of the series, which shows how Prohibition came about, is at 8:25 next Saturday. Comedy just around the corner tonight here on BBC Two with